Shalom, we're continuing our lessons in the Hebrew alphabet, letters two by two. We're coming down to the wire. If you still don't have your font chart, please click the link below and get it. The first letter we're going to cover today is the Gimel. It makes a G, hard G sound. It's a third letter and its number value is 3. You can see that it's a narrow letter. And the picture meaning is either a camel or a foot. It has to do with moving along by foot. We're going to compare the Gimel to a letter we learned much earlier, which was the Nun. Both letters are the same height and the same width. But you see the Gimel has that extra piece of maybe a shoe. Maybe it looks like a high heel, so you can remember it's a foot. It's split at the bottom, and the Nun is solid at the bottom. We also have the very last letter today, and that's the Tav. It makes a T sound. Its number value is 400, and its picture meaning is a mark. Now we want to compare. We see 3 different fonts of Tav. That's the right column. The middle column is another letter we've learned, which is the Chet, which is the 8th letter. And the difference between the Tav and the Chet is that the Tav has a little toe sticking out from it. The column on the left is the He, and that letter has a space in it. We've already compared the Chet to the He. So here we see the space for the air to go through. He. Here is the progression of the letter Tav coming from the Paleo-Hebrew, in which it looks like an X. It's kind of interesting. Maybe you saw some old movie where the person was illiterate. And they just said, just make your mark here where they're supposed to sign. And so it looks like an X. You can see if you would swivel it around a bit, it comes up to what comes to be our T through the Phoenician, through the Greek, and to the English. So it's kind of interesting that the mark is kind of like a T shape. So Gimel and Tav together spell a word. It's the name of the place, which is Gat, and you probably have heard of it as Gath, and it's the home city for Goliath. In Joshua 11:22, none of the Anakim were left in the land of the children of Israel. They remained only in Gaza, in Gath, in Gat, and in Ashdod, along the sea coast there. In Joshua 19:10, we're going to read this. It'll be relevant in a moment. And verse 13, they are dividing up the land among the tribes in Joshua. The third lot came out for the children of Zebulun according to their families, and the border of their inheritance was as far as Sarid. And in verse 13, and from there it passed along to the east of Gat Hefer toward Et Kazin, and extended to Rimon, which borders on Nea. So we see this a lot of times that some city will have the same name, it'll be in a different part of the country. So the first Gat we talked about is in Gaza, and then we have Gat Hefer, which is in the tribal lands of Zebulun, and then there's another Gat, which is in Joshua 19:45, naming cities, Yehud, B'nai Barak, and Gat Rimon. Now we're going to see in a minute that the word Gat actually means wine press. So these cities are named regionally for maybe perhaps there was a big wine press there. Now, Gat Hefer is interesting because in 2 Kings 14:25, we see, he restored the territory of Israel from the entrance of Hamat to the Sea of Arava, according to the word of Yehovah, God of Israel, which he had spoken through his servant Jonah, the son of Amittai, the prophet who was from Gat Hefer. Now, this is the only place where this prophecy of Jonah is preserved. We're familiar with the book of Jonah, where he is called to go to Nineveh and encourage the people to repent. And of course, he goes in the other direction, but eventually he gets there after being swallowed by a large sea creature. But we see that he's from Gat Hefer, and you can see in the map where that is. Remember, we're talking about the area of Zebulun. Well, in Mark 4:15, it talks about this land. It's the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali, by the way of the sea, beyond Jordan, Galilee of the Gentiles. This Gat Hefer, where Jonah is from, is in the Galilee. So what happens later? John 7:52. They answered and said to him, "Are you also from Galilee? Search and look, for no prophet has arisen out of Galilee." Well, nobody searched and looked, because if they did, they would find out that, in fact, Jonah came out of Galilee. And it's quite interesting that when the people ask for a sign, Yeshua says, the only sign you will get is the sign of Jonah. And they talked about the being in the belly of the fish and being in the earth. But look at that. Jonah's also out of Galilee. So as we said, gat, the word gat by itself means wine press. It's a kind of interesting picture. You have the picture of the leg or the foot, and then you have the picture of the mark. Well, just think about the people that are in the wine press. They're stomping grapes. I bet their legs are well marked. If you have ever been at a Passover service where somebody spilled grape juice or wine on the white tablecloth, and it was well marked. Judges 6:11. And there came an angel of Jehovah and sat under an oak, which was in Ophrah, that pertained to Joash the Abiezrite, and his son Gideon threshed wheat by the winepress to hide it from the Midianites. So we see here is the brave Gideon threshing wheat inside a winepress. Well, he turned out to be brave later. In Nehemiah 13:15, in those days saw I in Judah some treading winepresses on the Shabbat, and bringing in sheaves and lading asses, as also wine, grapes, and figs, and all manner of burdens which they brought into Jerusalem on the Shabbat day. And I testified against them in the day wherein they sold victuals. There is no buying and selling on Shabbat. Nehemiah is trying to get the people to be obedient to Torah. Now there's another gat, but it actually appears in the New Testament. It's a place we called Gethsemane. So there it is in Greek. It is a transliteration. It's not a translation. It's they took the actual word and they put it into the Greek alphabet. So you can see it's of Aramaic origin, this word got that we're talking about, and the word shemen, which means oil. So we see in Matthew 26:36, here comes Yeshua with the disciples to a place called Gethsemane, Gethshemen, the olive press, and saith unto the disciples, "Sit ye here while I go and pray yonder." If you're going to have an olive press, it's good to have it near where the olives are growing. Again in Luke 22, verses 39 and 44, and he came out and went, as was his wont, to the Mount of Olives. This is where Gethshemen is. And his disciples also followed him. And being in an agony, he prayed more earnestly, and his sweat was, as it were, great drops of blood falling down to the ground. So here is a picture of the olive press, which is in, I believe, the first century village in Nazareth. So the olives are poured into this big stone base, and there's a very heavy rock, maybe weighing even up to 1,000 pounds, and it's attached to the yoke of the donkey. And the donkey walks around, and that big stone rock rolls over the olives to press the oil out of them. You can see how the symbolism of the great pressure that Yeshua was under while he was praying that prayer in the garden. After the olives are pressed by that rock, the oil is strained through baskets. And then they take the pulp that's left over and they press it again with rocks directly on the basket. And in fact, there are three pressings of the olive oil, which speaks to the three different times that Yeshua prayed while he was in the garden there. And we read this in Isaiah 53:5. And I chose this translation deliberately. He was wounded because of our rebellious deeds, crushed because of our sins. He endured punishment that made us well. Because of his wounds, we have been healed. A lot of the translations use the word bruised because of our iniquities. It takes a lot more than bruising to get the oil out of an olive. And so we see as Yeshua is in Gethsemane, he fulfills this prophecy. He was crushed like the olives in the olive press. Here is our memory verse from Isaiah 63:2. I'll read it slowly, and I'll read it word by word with translation, and I will read it slowly again. I hope you were able to keep up. You know almost all the letters now, so try and keep up with the reading. Madua Adom Lilvushecha U Vigadecha Kadorech Bagat. Madua, why? Adom, red. Lilvushecha, to your clothing. Uvgadecha, another word for clothing or attire. Perhaps raiment is a nice fancy word. Your raiment, kadorech, like one who is trotting, who is plodding, who is walking heavily, bagat, in the winepress. This speaking of Yeshua when he comes out of Botsra in Edom. Again, Madua Adom Lilvushecha Uvgadecha Kedorech Bagat. Next lesson will be the very end. Until that time, Tasimita Einayim Al Hashamayim, keep your eye on the sky, your redemption draweth nigh. Shalom.